Hello again! Be here and welcome back to biology. We're still talking about cells, but today we're focusing on one specific part of the cell, the cell membrane. Before we get started, a quick question. Do you like to go swimming? And better yet, do you like to jump in and make a huge splash? This antacid tablet can make quite a splash too. In fact, it does more than splash. It fizzes and makes bubbles. But what's really going on here? If you watch closely, as it fizzes, it's dissolving. If we watch long enough, it will have completely disappeared into the water. Would that happen to us too after jumping in the pool? I hope not. Do you remember the rule that you learned in the last unit? Like dissolves like? Well, we know that our cells have a large percentage of water inside of them. So if placed in a watery environment, like a swimming pool, the rule suggests that our cells would simply dissolve. And without our cells, well, there's not much of us left. Luckily, our cells have a protective layer around them called the cell membrane, which keeps this from happening. So you can swim all day long with no worries of dissolving like an antacid tablet. Thank goodness! Today, we'll look at how the chemical structure of the cell membrane makes this possible. As we go through the lesson today, we'll begin by describing the chemical structure of the cell membrane and how this results in selective permeability. We'll also explain the role played by protein and cholesterol molecules in the cell membrane. On most cell diagrams, the cell membrane is simply drawn as a thin line around the outside. But it is so much more complicated than that. In this 3D rendering of the cell, we can see that the membrane looks like a double layer of complex molecules. This is closer to being accurate, but it's still overly simplified and missing a few things, which we'll discover as we go through the lesson. Sometimes you'll also see it referred to as the plasma membrane. The structure of the cell membrane has a specific description. It is a phospholipid bilayer. You learned about phospholipids in the previous unit, but just in case that word still sounds a little like an alien language, let's dissect it to figure out what it means. The word begins with phospho, which means that it has a phosphate group. Phosphates are charged molecules that contain the element phosphorus. Remember that we called charged molecules polar. From the previous unit, you know that lipids are made of nonpolar fatty acids. And bilayer means that it has two layers. So a phospholipid bilayer is simply a double layer of phosphate lipids. Another term often used to describe the cell membrane is fluid mosaic. Again, we can dissect the word to find out that the cell membrane is fluid, meaning it is flexible and can move, and that it is a mosaic, meaning that it is made of many different things. In this animation of the cell membrane, you can see both properties. It moves and has various pieces embedded in it. The membrane is composed primarily of phospholipids. Remember from Unit 2 that a single phospholipid contains a phosphate head and a fatty acid tail. The phosphate head is hydrophilic, meaning that it likes water. Because remember, phosphate is polar, and so is water. Water molecules are too attracted to each other to be attracted to something else that doesn't also have a charge. The fatty acid tail is hydrophobic, meaning that it does not like water. Or perhaps it would be better to say that water doesn't like fatty acids because they don't have a charge. You'll often see phospholipids drawn as just a circle for the head and a long curvy piece for the tail. But remember that you do actually know what's going on behind the scenes there on a molecular level. In a phospholipid bilayer, or cell membrane, the phospholipids always line up tail to tail, with the hydrophilic heads facing the outside and the hydrophobic tails on the inside. This is because the outside faces of the membrane will come in contact with water molecules and often form hydrogen bonds with them, so the outside of the membrane needs to be polar. The fact that the inside of the membrane is a non-polar lipid is what keeps water from dissolving the cell, because we know that lipids won't dissolve in water. This pattern repeats all the way around the cell, enclosing it in a lipid bilayer membrane. We said in the beginning of this lesson that the chemical structure is what allows the membrane to be selectively permeable. And now that you know which parts are polar and nonpolar, we should be able to explain why that is. We know that the cell membrane needs to allow certain substances in and out. Obviously, your cells need a constant supply of oxygen coming in, and they need to be able to let carbon dioxide out. If either of these molecules had a hard time getting across the membrane, it would be difficult for your cells to function. Because the membrane is selectively permeable, some substances are able to pass through, but others are not. Small, nonpolar molecules like oxygen and carbon dioxide can always get across the membrane easily because they are not rejected by the nonpolar interior of the membrane. Since they can pass directly through the cell membrane with no interference, this makes it easy for your cells to exchange oxygen and carbon dioxide with blood vessels. So small, nonpolar molecules have it easy. Other small but polar molecules, like water, can sometimes slip through, though more often than not, the nonpolar lipid tails will block these molecules. Large molecules like glucose have a very hard time passing through, simply due to their size. And charged ions, like sodium and potassium, will almost always be rejected by the nonpolar lipid tails inside the membrane. So, the selective permeability of the cell is a direct result of the chemical structure of the membrane. Those nonpolar tails will let in other small nonpolar molecules, but they are not very friendly to what they see as polar invaders. But doesn't the cell sometimes need to move larger or polar molecules through the membrane? What then? If a molecule cannot pass directly through the membrane, the cell will have a special protein channel designed to let it in. It's like it has its own door! These special doors are called membrane proteins. An example of a membrane protein is an aquaporin, which is a channel that allows large quantities of water to pass through. These channels can be opened or closed, just like a water faucet, depending on the needs of the cell at any moment. And if you are currently swimming, those channels need to be closed so that water from the pool doesn't overrun your cells and dissolve them. In addition to aquaporins, the cell has many other types of protein channels to let all different types of molecules through. Besides acting as transport channels, proteins embedded in the membrane have other functions as well. Some act as markers for identification by neighboring cells. Others can be attachment points for pieces of the cytoskeleton. And some even aid in the communication with nearby cells. Proteins are not the only molecules you'll find embedded in the membrane. You'll also see many cholesterol molecules, another type of lipid that you learned about in a previous lesson, mixed in with phospholipids. These help the membrane stay flexible. Remember that it is a fluid mosaic, not rigid. Without the cholesterol molecules, the membrane would not be able to bend as well. Things that can't bend tend to break instead, and we definitely don't want that. What about our other category of macromolecules, carbohydrates? Yep, you'll find those in the membrane too. Like proteins, they help the cell be identifiable to neighbors, especially to immune system cells. Proteins, lipids, and carbohydrates are all important for a well-functioning cell membrane. They give protection, aid in transportation, and allow communication with other cells, all making up this fluid mosaic membrane around the cell. So, instead of drawing our cell membrane as a single line, that line should probably look more like this. No wonder no one wants to draw that every time, though. Our goal for today was to be able to explain how the chemical structure of the cell membrane allows it to be selectively permeable. We now know that it is because of the nonpolar lipid tails that form the interior of the membrane. They will only allow small nonpolar molecules to pass through directly. Other molecules will need some help, which leads us to our second goal. It's the membrane proteins which allow the larger and polar molecules to get through when they need to. All of this selective permeability means that your cells, and therefore you, won't dissolve like the antacid tablet next time you go swimming. Your phospholipid bilayers protect your cells from such a watery death. Your cells can definitely let water in when they want to, but keep it out when necessary. Thank goodness. We've said so far that the membrane is permeable to some substances, but we haven't looked at exactly how they get through the membrane. Does that process happen all on its own, or does it need a little help? We'll answer that question in more detail next time. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. See you next time.